Thank you all for coming out. I appreciate the invitation by Alan. He's been a friend of ours for many years and always a friend of poetry. As he has told you, the book we're inviting your attention toward is called Shadow Box, and it's poems that are cast in a form I've been trying to develop for a long time. Never quite settled on a name for this mutant species. It's enclosed, embedded, doubled, inlaid. I've been thinking lately of calling them sunken poems. Any rate, these terms are supposed to suggest a poem that is enclosed inside another poem. There is a poem, and then there is a poem that surrounds it. Usually at readings I spend some time explaining this form, but I check you all out, and this is a very sophisticated audience, and you don't need any explanation. So we'll just go ahead and present the examples from this volume called Shadow Box. The neatest trick I pulled off with the stuff has been to persuade the lovely and gracious Susan Nichols Chappell to perform the poems with me. Public appearances are not her favorite things to do in this world, but I pleaded necessity and begged, cajoled, bribed, and here, ladies and gentlemen, is Susan. And the poem we will read first is called Searchlight. It's a character portrait poem, but the character portrayed is absent. What we see is the study of this theoretical astronomer, his private study at his home. He stepped out of the room for a moment, leaving his cluttered table at rest. The light from his table lamp shines on a page of calculation, and that light is reflected through his window into the darkness of the night outside. Searchlight.
The page of numerate thought shines on the table where the scholar's lamp burns bright, sending through the slot of his window square a shaft of patient light.
The hamlet sleeps under November stars. Only
the page of numerate thought
toils through the darkness,
shines on the table where,
askew and calm,
the scholar's lamp burns bright
and scars the silence,
sending through the slot
the bars and angles
of his window square
a true, clean ray,
a shaft of patient light,
its purview lonely and remote as the gleam of Mars. Sometimes these interior poems describe the thoughts or actions of a person, and then when you get the whole poem, the situation in which that person is involved is revealed. And this is the case with the poem called Revenant. The term revenant means the ghost of someone or something which returns from the past. It brings with it memories and feelings, usually fear, of a time long ago. Here in Revenant, we have a woman who has come mostly to graceful grips with the advance of age, but then
she lays the single hair that gives the lie to truth across the palm of her hand, conjures in near despair the glory that was youth, the grandeur that was blonde.
cleaning her comb, she finds a remnant trace and sighs.
She lays this single hair,
this one revenant,
that gives the lie to truth,
a lone survivor,
across the palm of her hand.
Her gaze transfixed
conjures in near despair
to erase from mind
the glory that was youth,
this sunshine thread,
the grandeur that was blonde,
now done, one golden strand among the thousand grays. Our friend Fritz Janska said that was a portrait of Susan, and she took exception. I'm on her side.
Untrue.
A second category I have been calling the perspective poems, which are often focused on visual images. In these poems, the voices or points of view are not distinguished by two speakers, but by splitting up the over voice of the poem. The outer voice presents a wide view of a scene. In film terms, you would call it a long or a medium long shot. And the inner voice presents the close-up of some detail in that larger picture. If you were to go over next door to the terrific bookshop over there and look at one of those handsome art books, you might find on one page a painting, and on another page a detail, a smaller detail from that painting, because it is of interest in itself. And that's the kind of thing we try to manage with these poems. The shift of perspective is supposed to give a dramatic interpretation to the visuals and kind of add a sense of depth. In this poem, called Passage, we see a vista of a dark pond at midnight, which reflects the night sky with the moon. The inner poem, which Susan's going to read, pictures something that takes place within the pond. A widely celebrated anniversary just now is of the 40th year since the Apollo moon landing, that giant leap for mankind. The dark pond of this poem, there lives an animal. The poem is called Passage.
A muskrat noses through the cool reflective moon that, trembling languidly, steadies itself again within the astonished O upon the water's plain.
Poem has a word in it, speculum. All that means is a round mirror. If you're of a certain age, you'll remember that doctors used to clamp them to the forehead to look at your tonsil. They don't do that anymore. They don't do a lot of things anymore. The solemn pond displays the summer night, perfect in the rondure of its speculum. The sky set out in order, light by light. Serenely,
a muskrat noses through
the lines of stars.
The cool reflective moon
sways in the water
that, trembling languidly,
but once now settles,
steadies itself again,
and shines impassive
within the astonished O,
again moveless
upon the water's plain,
immense. Something has happened in the world this night, a rare consequence for some time to come, whether or not it alters the final sum. Thank you.